Why did Mary offer a sacrifice in Luke 2:21 for her sin?
Where does it say it was for her sin? It
was for her uncleanness. She offered, what's that?
Uncleanness in Jewish studies, as you should well know, does not mean anything necessarily something sinful. For instance, if a human being touches the scriptures, you become unclean. Does touching the Bible make you commit a sin?
Was it a sin in Leviticus 12 enough to have a sacrificial offering?
If you touch the Bible, you have to go to the mikvah.
What I'm saying is, why did she think that she had to offer that offering if what you're saying is true?
Okay, because along with touching scripture, another sacred item is blood. And after birth, for a month or so, I'm told, I've never given birth, but I'm told that the women continue to have bleeding. And so that period of waiting before a sacrifice is to make sure the bleeding stops after giving birth. And then the woman is, you know, considered to be sacred. She also she's unclean after her period, not because that's a sin, but because the blood she sheds is sacred, as is all blood. And so a sacrifice is offered.
Walter.
Now Mary goes ahead and offers the sacrifice, and our understanding of her offering of the sacrifice is that she had no need to, but she did to obey the Jewish law, just like Jesus had no need to be circumcised, but he was. He had no need to offer two turtle doves for himself, but they were offered. He had no need to pay the temple tax, but he did.
But Jesus never made
so that she obeys Jewish law the way her son, who had no need to obey Jewish law.
I know
law,
Walter
doesn't.
Wants to jump in on it, but you also have a statement by Mary herself at that point.
But also one of the things that in terms of...
Let's stick right on that point, and then we'll go on.
Because one of the things that you also have to deal with, because you mentioned a lot of stuff.
Well, let's get a response on what we're talking about
in
terms of Mary.
My homework.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of stuff here, okay?
Yeah.
All right, look, you said something very important. It's really a key.
Mm-hmm.
You said the Immaculate Conception in 1854 was the result of the long centuries of the accumulated community of the church, right?
Right.
I want you to listen to some of the long centuries. Clement of Alexandria. Mm-hmm. The Word, Jesus Christ, alone was born without sin. Mm-hmm. Augustine, Bishop of Hippo, one of the greatest theologians in the church. He, Christ, alone being made a man, but remaining God, never had any sin, nor did he take on flesh of sin, though he took flesh of the sin of his mother. Ambrose, of all that are born of women, the Holy Lord Jesus was the only one who experienced not the contagion of earthly corruption. St. Bernard, for this reason our astonishment is not small, in seeing that some of you are believed to be able to introduce a new feast that is unknown to the rite of the church, that cannot be approved by reason that it is condemned by the ancient traditions, the feast of the Immaculate Conception. You and Bernard do not agree,
and
he's canonized.
And that's
you're
right.
Not.
But
can I finish?
You
can just go on from there. But
one of the things about Bernard is that he was wrong, because there was a long existing feast, often called the feast of Saint Anne giving birth or conceiving Mary, and it was referred
Immaculate Conception.
But it was of Saint Anne conceiving Mary without
recognizing
sin.
I don't think it was without sin.
And one of the things about Bernard's statement is that he does not deny the Immaculate Conception as it's understood. He denied in his statement that you're quoting there, if you quote the rest of it, that he denied that she was immaculate before she was conceived. And St. Thomas Aquinas makes the same denial. Neither Thomas nor Bernard believe that Mary was sinless before she was conceived.
They don't believe she was sinless afterwards either.
They don't say that. They
didn't pose
the question.
Let me give it to you. What honor should we believe in attributing to Mary that honor may be had, you say, for her conception, Thomas, which was anterior to her birth. Because without this conception, neither her birth should be honored. Then would you say, if others, according to your own reasoning, were to maintain that it is necessary to hold feasts in honor of her parents? This is logical. This is the angelic doctor. Then it would be necessary to honor her grandparents and her great-grandparents. And it would be no end at all. There would be feasts without number on the earth, and it would be converted into a paradise. Again, that's Thomas Aquinas, okay? Again, Peter Lombard. But this is asked, on what account and whence is it that Mary was conceived without original sin? We say this was impossible. Melchior Canus, famous professor of canon law and dogmatic theology on the subject. The dogma holds the Blessed Virgin was free from the original sin was nowhere delivered in Holy Scripture. Mm-hmm. St. Antoninus, if the Scriptures are duly considered and the sayings of the doctors, ancient and modern, who have been devoted to the glorious Virgin, mm-hmm. it is plain from their words she was conceived in sin. Close quote. Leo the First, the Lord Jesus Christ, alone among the sons of men, was born without sin. Mm-hmm. Pope Gelatus, it belongs to the Immaculate Lamb to have no sin. Gregory the First, mm-hmm. Christ alone was truly born holy. Innocent the Third, Eve was produced without sin, but she brought forth in sin. Mary was brought forth in sin, but she brought forth without sin.